Hello students, this is Dr. Smita Nayak, professor and HOD at Gehlot Institute of Pharmacy and your teacher for this semester for the very important subject of audits and regulatory compliances. So in my topic today, in my lecture today, I am going to give you an overview of audits and regulatory compliance. The word audit is something which all of us have heard somewhere or the other. Similarly, regulatory compliance is a topic that you have touched upon in brief in your previous semester. Understand that auditing is a very vital function within a pharmaceutical company. And because it is involved with improvement in the quality of the process and the order product, the word audit is also used as the word quality audit. So whether I use the word audit or quality audit in my lecture, both mean the same thing. Quality audit is a review and evaluation of the entire quality system or a part of the quality system, and the objective behind auditing is to improve the quality systems of the pharmaceutical company. As we know, good quality system ensures that a product is of good quality, and this is very beneficial to a company in terms of export of its pharmaceutical products. Thus, audit is a means to examine the pharmacy program, system and processes and ensure that the procedures that are used in the pharmaceutical organization and the mechanisms that are in place for establishing and improving the quality comply with the regulatory requirements. Thus, audits are conducted to ascertain the validity and reliability of the information that the company puts in the public domain. It also provides an assessment of the internal controls that are in place within the organization. In short, audits provide the management with information on efficiency with which the company is able to control the quality of its processes and products. So thus, in this subject of audits and regulatory compliance, we are going to look at what is audit, what are the requirements for carrying out an audit, and we are also going to look at sample audits or mock audits that are necessary to be carried out. While audit is a very general, simple term, as we go further, we will look at the classification and the different types of audits that are necessary to be conducted by an organization and the way in which the organization carries out these audits. Another important thing to remember is a successful audit is possible only when it has the support of the top management, and therefore it is necessary that the management understands the importance of audits and the compliance with requirements by different regulatory agencies, not only of our country but different countries. Thus, in this lecture we are going to look at audit, types of audit, as well as the methodologies that are employed in carrying out audits. And as quality students of M.Pharm Quality Assurance, remember it is very important for you to understand the basics of audit. Therefore, I recommend that you do a lot of self-study and reading of the different audit protocols, audit processes and its need and the regulations with which audits need to comply. So let us move forward to understanding more about audits and regulatory compliance. First, begin with understanding the definition of the audit or the quality audit. Quality audit is defined as a systematic and independent examination to determine whether the activities and the related results comply with the planned arrangements
and whether these arrangements are implemented effectively and are suitable to achieve the desired objectives. Now, this is a very complicated definition, but if you were to break it down into smaller parts and correlate it to a pharmaceutical organization where the quality of the product has to be assured, then quality audit is a systematic and independent. Remember, I cannot audit myself. Okay, someone else has to audit me. So, independent examination to determine that whatever activities, processes were carried out and the results obtained comply with the desired outcome and whether these arrangements are implemented effectively. So, whatever systems are in place, whether they are implemented effectively and are suitable to achieve the desired objectives. Thus, quality audit means a systematic examination of the quality system. And what do we mean by quality system? All of you have learnt about quality assurance in the last semester, where you know that pre-planned activities, documented activities, processes, validation, calibration, confirmation, verification are all incorporated into the system to generate a quality product. Thus, the quality audit is a systematic examination of all these systems responsible for building quality into the product. Typically, the quality audits are performed at defined intervals. Any failure in the implementation of the quality systems becomes contraindicatory to the audit and therefore may be published publicly and may lead to serious consequences such as revocation or cancellation of the quality certificate that has been awarded to the company. So, quality audit is a very serious matter, needs to be taken up by the top management to the bottom worker at a very serious level and needs to be incorporated and practiced on a daily basis. Auditing of all the systems responsible for quantity, for the quality of the product is very, very necessary. Now, why and how we will see as we go into the further slides.
Let us begin with the objectives that are achieved by carrying out an audit. Commonly, the pharmaceutical manufacturers use these audits as an effective mechanism to verify compliance with GMP. All of us know what is GMP, good manufacturing practices. GMP audits help in achieving two important goals. One is that the audits are intended to verify that manufacturing and control systems are operational under a state of control. So what this means is that audit is to verify that there is a control over everything that goes inside the organization, whether it is the manufacturing or it is the testing or quality control of the manufactured product. Also, audits permit timely correction of potential problems. So, once a problem is detected, it can be corrected in a small amount of time, thus allowing correction to the quality of the product. Lastly, audits can be used to establish a high degree of confidence to remain under an adequate level of control by the management. So, it gives confidence to the management that the entire process is under their control and adheres to the and gives us products of the desired quality. In order to carry out the audit successfully, the objectives for the audit should be laid down in advance. And these objectives could be based on the requirements of the management and could include the management system requirements, compliance with statutory regulations and contractual requirements, need for supplier evaluation, especially suppliers of raw materials and packaging materials. It could be for complying with certain customer requirements, or the audit could help in satisfying the needs of other interested parties, for example, third parties or those who are interested in importing the goods from the pharmaceutical organization. Also, audit will help to reduce the risk to the organization, and it helps in meeting the management priorities. Thus, these are in general some of the objectives of the audit and the purpose for which the audit is carried out. The very first step in carrying out an audit is to manage the resources. Remember, auditing is a big task that involves a huge number of people, a team of experts, and it involves the auditing of various processes, systems, and departments within the organization. Therefore, a number of resources have to be allocated by the management to carrying out of audits. Hence, like I told you earlier, unless the management is committed to carrying out the audit to improve the quality of the process and the product, audit will not be successful. So the very first step in the in auditing is to allocate resources for the same. Therefore, let us see what are the resources that are required for a successful audit. Financial resources necessary to develop, implement, manage, and improve the audit activities. Training of the personnel and imparting the skills, as well as use of the latest audit techniques, software that is necessary. Processes to achieve and maintain the competence of auditors and to improve the auditor performance. Remember, newer rules and regulations keep coming up on a daily basis. So the countries to which the management plans to export their pharmaceutical products, they need to know the requirements of those countries, and therefore they need skilled auditors to carry out this audit program, and therefore it is necessary to have competent auditors and to give them training, as well as to see that motivate them to improve their performance. Good auditors are very difficult to find. Therefore, resources have to be allocated to make auditors as well as technical experts available for carrying out the audit and achieving the audit program objectives. The degree and extent of the audit program, is it superficial, is it in-depth, and what it requires to comply with has to be planned, and resources have to be allocated for that. And lot of practical issues such as the traveling from one location to other, accommodation needs, other needs such as stationery, computer, software, etc. for auditing has to needs resources, and therefore allocation of resources is very, very important. So first and foremost is financial resources, auditing techniques, imparting skills and training to the auditors, improving the audit performance and improving their competence is another important area. Availability of auditors and technical experts having the competence. The depth to which the audit program is meant to be carried out and other miscellaneous expenses all have to be managed efficiently, planned for, budgeted for by the management. Thus, the very first important step in carrying out an audit is to manage the resources so that all these requirements are fulfilled. So what exactly does the management do when it has to plan and carry out an audit is PDCA. It plans the audit program. It implements the audit program, that is the do part. C is checking of the result and the report of the audit program, and then acting upon the recommendations that have come out of the audit program in order to improve the audit program. So the audit process by itself involves four activities: planning of the audit, actual conducting the audit or doing the audit, monitoring and review of the audit program, that is checking of the audit program itself, and improving the audit program. So all this leads to an effective, efficient audit program, which when carried out, when auditing is done, leads to detection of problems and discrepancies in the process and product, which can be immediately acted upon and improved, thus giving the management the advantage of having quality goods to cater to the requirements of the market. So this is what is done by the management. You can see on the right hand side of the slide. Constitute a team of experts. Now who are these experts? What is this team? If you want to carry out an audit, you will require auditors from different backgrounds, right from a technical background such as pharmacy, to a instrumentation, to an engineer, to an financial guy, etc. So an entire team is required to assess the system, to assess the procedure, and to assess the product. They are provided with training on how to carry out the audit effectively. Then once the auditors are trained and ready to carry out the audit schedule is fixed, and they will carry out the audit as per the schedule and report the audit findings to the top management and suggest corrective actions. Okay. Once based on this, a repeat audit may be carried out in order to check whether the suggestions have been implemented. The actual audit program should address the following. There should be planning and scheduling of the audit. You cannot just carry out an audit out of the blue, because a lot of resources go into planning of the audits, and if the audit is not carried out properly, this can lead to a loss of time, effort, and money. Also, the auditors and the audit team leaders have to be competent enough, which means they should be trained, and then they should take up the audit program. Then comes selecting the appropriate audit team. So depending on which area, which sphere of activity is to be audited, the appropriate audit team has to be put together, and they have to be assigned their roles and responsibilities. Very important. Then the actual audit is to be carried out. If necessary, a follow-up audit may be carried out as per requirements. Appropriate audit program records need to be maintained, and this is very, very important, because when there is an external agency coming in to monitor your quality systems, then the first thing they are going to look at is the internal audit program records. It is very essential to monitor the performance and effectiveness of this audit program, as a lot of time, money, and effort has been invested by the management in carrying out the audit program, and it should not be a fruitless exercise. Finally, the audit report and the audit team should approach the top management and inform them about the overall achievements of this audit program. So what is this documentation that I am talking about in an audit? The audit program should be well documented, and records should be maintained to demonstrate the implementation of the audit program, and should include, okay, very important. Now read this very carefully. What are the various documents that need to be maintained, generated and maintained? First is the records related to each and every audit that has been conducted in the premises of the company, including the plan of audit, the report of the audit, the non-conformity, that is the discrepancies that have been detected during the auditing. Also, what corrective action, what preventive action was taken based on these to close these non-conformity reports, and audit follow-up reports, if any. Next is the results of the audit program review. And finally, records related to audit personnel, such as the competence of the auditor, the performance evaluation of the auditor, the training and the skills of the auditor, the experience of the auditor, selection of the audit team, to show that it is appropriate, and maintenance and improvement of competence of the auditors. So very important is the quality of auditors, the competence of the auditors, in order to demonstrate that the auditing has been carried out by a team that is having suitable experience and expertise to carry out the audit. All these records should be generated, they should be retained and suitably safeguarded and available for anyone, any regulatory agency that wants to go through these records. The management expects that those who are assigned the responsibility for maintaining the audit program should establish the objectives and extent of the audit program, establish the responsibilities and procedures, and should ensure that the resources are provided, ensure effective implementation of the audit program, ensure that the appropriate audit program records are maintained, and finally monitor, review, and improve the audit program itself. Okay, so remember that there has to be effective communication and coordination between the top management who is assigning responsibility for planning and arranging and carrying out audit, that is the audit management team, and the department, system or process which is being audited or called as auditee. So all these three have to liaise with each other in such a manner that the audit management team understands the requirements of the top management, and it audits the process or the department, and it is able to generate a successful audit report and give it back to the top management, which will then act upon the observations in the audit program, the recommendations to remove the discrepancies, and it will take appropriate action to improve the auditing. See, overall result, the overall expectation of this entire exercise is to improve the quality of the system, the product, the process, in such a manner that no regulatory agency is able to find any or able to have any complaint against the pharmaceutical firm regards quality of the product. Now, who will carry out this responsibility? To whom will the top management assign this responsibility? Let's see. The responsibility for managing an audit program should be assigned to a team. It could be one individual or more individuals with a general understanding of audit principles, of the competence of the auditors, and how to apply the audit techniques. So this team members should not only have management skills, they should have technical skills, as well as they should understand the commercial aspect of the activities to be audited and be able to carry out a successful audit and generate an audit report. The purpose of the audit is to find out the discrepancies or deficiencies in the system or the process that can impact the quality of the end product. Therefore, the deficiencies that are pointed out by the audit team can be classified under quality deficiency, identity deficiency, potency problems, purity problems, or safety problems. And it will try to pinpoint the exact nature of the deficiency in the system, and it will look at the it will look at the risk involved if the deficiency is not corrected. It will look at scientific data which indicates that the deficiency is serious in nature. It will try to investigate the reason for occurrence of this deficiency and the severity of the deficiency. So the audit team looks at deficiencies from the quality point of view, identity point of view, potency point of view, purity and safety, and looks at the risks involved, looks at the data in a scientific manner and investigates the occurrence, why it has occurred, and the severity which can lead to problems. This classification of deficiency is based upon the safety, rights or well-being of the human or animal trial subjects, the impact of the deficiency on the quality of the product, the purity of the product, the efficacy or integrity of the product. Also, it audits the regulated data and determines its integrity, and it evaluates if any scientific misconduct has been carried out. Thus, the audit team classifies the deficiencies into four categories: either critical, major, minor, or in the form of a very slight aberration, for which they may give a recommendation to improve the existing quality. Thus, the deficiencies that are pointed out by any regulatory agencies are either critical in nature, major in nature, minor in nature, or none, but a recommendation is given by an auditing team. If you look at the various US FDA audits that have been carried out on various pharmaceutical companies in India and their deficiency classifications, you will understand the nature of the deficiencies. Several examples exist and you can find them on the net, or you can see them in the newspapers about major deficiency, critical deficiency, and the reason for which the grave corrections are necessary. Sometimes you will find that the entire consignment of a particular company has been rejected because of a major deficiency or a critical deficiency. Okay, so you can go through literature available on the net and literature that is available in other media such as print media, which will give you a much better idea with practical examples about audits and the deficiencies that are pointed out by the audit team. Before we proceed ahead, let me give you one or two examples in very simple language to understand about the critical nature of the deficiencies and the losses that would be incurred if the company ignores these deficiencies. Now, this was published, this is a published data by Lakmin Consultant USA, where there are two case studies which I have taken up, and these have been pointed out by the auditors in a pharmaceutical organizations in India. This is study one, wherein a large India-based manufacturer received a warning letter from their India facility somewhere in 2015. Because the warnings were of a critical nature, the deficiency was identified as a major deficiency, the company was forced to move its entire generic production from that facility which received a critical warning to a newer facility. The cost, or the rather the loss involved in carrying out the shifting of the manufacturing from that facility which was not recommended by the auditors, was to the tune of $133 million. So there was huge revenue loss and cost involved. Okay, not only that, because of that, the there was a loss in time in carrying out this transfer of production from one facility to another. At least 18 months were lost when the facility production was shifted somewhere else. Also, the legal expenses involved were to the tune of 25 to 45 million. And therefore, there was a huge reduction in the profit and increase in expenses, miscellaneous expenses, to the tune of 13.5 million. The impact on the delay in new drug application and abbreviated new drug application, which is what needs to be filed for a new product and for a generic product, was not calculated. So see the losses involved. 133 million, around 45 million, around $13.5 million, plus miscellaneous, the impact due to delay in filing of the applications. Okay, so this is how serious the audit program can lead to. These are the consequences that can be felt if the product quality, the process quality is not up to the mark and the recommendations of the auditors are not taken up seriously. Another case study that was published by Lakmin Consultant is again for an India-based manufacturer which received an FDA import alert in 2013. Now, the companies have not been named here. They have been kept confidential. But if you go back into the print media, you will find out all this. And there was a recall of multiple products. The company still did not pay attention. They did not carry out audits the way it should be carried out, and they did not comply with the recommendations of the audit team. A second facility import alert was issued, and the entire company was blacklisted. All the products that had reached US had to be recalled in 2015. Can you imagine the losses? They were to the tune of $911 million. US revenues dropped from 50% to 24%. Total revenue loss of $760 million is expected. And all those products that were recalled had to be written off. They had to be destroyed. So, and there were legal expenses to the tune of $18 million. Further expenses were expected to mount to more than $100 million. So, further loss in opportunity was around $51 million. And several other expenses, that is 7.2 million units had to be recalled. So many billions of dollars was lost because of destruction of the samples. So you can see the significance of audits now. I hope with these two examples, you are able to understand why auditing has gained prominence in recent years, why the auditing team needs to be efficient, well-trained and able to analyze the situation, point out the deficiencies and recommend corrections. Because if it does not function efficiently, if auditing is not taken seriously by the top management, the losses could be to the tune of thousands of million dollars, which means that the company is going to go bust. It is very important to note here that the quality should be built into the product, and testing alone cannot be relied upon to ensure product quality. All of us know this, and we have learnt this as students of quality assurance. Therefore, one of the important aspects of building in quality into the product is audit, audit, and audit. And this quality audit or audit of the quality system provides the foundation for manufacturing systems that are linked and function within it. In this diagram is shown a relationship among the six systems, that is the quality system as well as the manufacturing systems, which includes production, facilities and equipment, laboratory controls, materials system and packaging and labeling. So if we consider these as the five important systems which are responsible for building quality into the product, there is a need to audit each of these independently. The product system, equipments and facilities, the laboratory control or the testing system, the materials system, as well as packaging and labeling system. So once all these are audited and these are under control, the quality is built into the system. Here we are deviating slightly from the topic of audits. because in the previous slide we looked at the importance of building quality into the product. So how do we ensure that quality is built into the product and that whenever an audit is carried out, no critical or major deficiencies are pointed out? So it is, you can divide the establishment of quality system into four different arenas, that is the management responsibility, allocation of resources, efficient manufacturing operations, and effective evaluation of quality of the product. So let us see what are the finer points that need to be noted and implemented. A good leadership, a good management can build good quality into the product. Such a good management should build in the quality system by adhering to various rules, regulations, recommendations. It should establish policies, objectives, and plans and carry out a systematic review periodically of the entire system. Coming to resources, all resources should be available for carrying out activities as per prescribed norms. The personnel that are deployed to carry out the various activities should be skilled, well-trained, motivated, and given adequate training to carry out their duties. The facilities and equipments should be state of the art. They should be calibrated, verified, maintained, records should be maintained, and all they should be operated by skilled technical persons. A good sturdy design of the product will help to ensure quality of the product as well as the process, ease of processing of the product. The inputs, that is the raw materials and the packaging materials, should be evaluated thoroughly, monitored thoroughly. The actual operations should be monitored, assessed, validated where necessary. Any non-conformities should not be pushed under the carpet. Rather, they should be pointed out, they should be brought to the front, and they should be addressed. Okay. Coming to evaluation, like I told you, it is no longer all about quality control but quality assurance. For which purpose, as a part of the quality assurance program, the data that is generated during manufacturing and testing should be analyzed to understand the trend. Conduct of internal audits is very, very important. The risk management initiatives should be in place. Corrective actions should be taken as and where necessary. Similarly, preventive actions, preventive maintenance should be encouraged, and continuous improvement should be promoted amongst the entire workforce of the organization. Thus, these four aspects, if implemented, that is management taking its own responsibility, allocation of appropriate resources, monitoring of manufacturing conditions and evaluation activities, can provide the controls to consistently produce a product of acceptable quality. And when everything falls into place and implementation of these principles is correct, the audit program and the audit process will not reveal any critical or major deficiencies. Rather, the audit will help in continuous improvement of quality in systems, processes, and the product. Here on this slide, I have put up the key concepts of all modern systems, quality systems. It begins with quality. That means every pharmaceutical product should have established identity, purity, and other quality characteristics designed to ensure the required level of safety and effectiveness. Now, in our BPharm program, we have all learnt about the identity, purity, safety, and efficacy of the pharmaceutical products. So I will not deal with it here. The next important aspect of modern quality system is QBD, or quality by design and product development. So the use of QBD in developing a product is very, very important, because designing and developing the product and the associated processes that are to be used during product development and product manufacture should be such that the product consistently attains a predefined quality at the end of the manufacturing process. Deficiencies are minimal, losses are minimal, and non-conformity to quality is almost non-existent, which is why QBD plays a very important role in product development. Next comes quality risk management, where a guide for setting the specification or process parameters is very necessary to assess and reduce the risk of changing the process or specification and determining the extent of discrepancy, investigation and corrective actions. Now remember one simple thing is that when a manufacturing process has been set up and it is transferred to the commercial scale, then if there are minimal changes required during the transfer from the pilot to the commercial scale, this indicates that the process is rugged, solid, stable, and will consistently give product of the required quality. Therefore, the parameters should be such set that there is minimal change in the process or the specification at a later date. Once set, the quality, the specifications, and the process should be consistent and there should be no change. In the case of any discrepancy, deviation, it is acceptable as long as immediate corrective and preventive actions are taken. This is also called as CAPA, corrective and preventive actions. So the CGMP regulatory concept says that investigation is fine. If there is a problem, in spite of everything, it is fine. But has it been investigated? Has the problem been understood? And has the problem been corrected in such a manner that there has been no discrepancy, there has been no reduction in the quality of the product? Once corrective and preventive action has been taken, if it is found that there is a need to change some process or equipment, then change control procedure has to be initiated. Change control is an effective change management concept that focuses on managing changes to prevent any unintended consequences such as poor quality of the product. Finally, coming to the quality unit, which is the quality control of the finished product. This quality control has to be carried out on not only the incoming raw materials, packaging materials, also evaluation of the performance of the manufacturing process. For example, validation of the mixing process, validation of compression, in-process quality control, specifications limits and acceptability limits of each batch have to be established. Quality assurance is the next important aspect, which involves review and approval of documents such as raw material specifications, finished material specifications and procedures, that is BMRs, SOPs, laying down of BMRs, SOPs, review of the batch manufacturing records and auditing and performing trend analysis and concluding whether the process of the product is of suitable quality. Okay, so both these aspects of quality control and quality assurance come under the quality unit. Thus, in this slide, we have looked at the key concepts in modern quality systems. To understand more about the pharmaceutical quality system, all of you all should read the ICH regulations Q10, which is based on the pharmaceutical quality system. The pharmaceutical quality system covers the entire life cycle of a product, which includes pharmaceutical development, transfer of technology to the commercial scale, commercial manufacture and testing, and product discontinuation. So the GMP aspects of this entire life cycle are discussed under the pharmaceutical quality system given in ICH Q10 and is a good reference for auditors who wish to audit the pharmaceutical organization. Similarly, ICH Q10 discusses the responsibilities of the management, which range from the process performance, product quality monitoring system that is auditing, the CAPA or corrective action preventive action system in place, change management, management review, and also discusses knowledge management as well as quality risk management. So before you proceed ahead to details about auditing, pause this video, go to ICHQ 10, read more about the pharmaceutical quality systems, and then proceed to auditing. So as we proceed further now, I am going to focus on audits and discuss the various types of audit and the activities involved in auditing. The quality audit system is classified into three different categories: the internal audits, external audits, and regulatory audits. By now, you have a very fair idea of what is an audit. So, what could be an internal audit and self audit? Internal audit can also be called as a self audit done by oneself. External audit is one where the company, the top management of the company, recruits external auditors who will come and audit the facility and prepare a report submitted to the top management. Regulatory audits are those that are carried out by regulatory agencies in order to fulfill various regulatory requirements. So let us proceed ahead and try to understand more about the different types of audits. Coming first to the internal audit program. As I told you, this is an audit that is carried out by a team comprising of employees of the organization. So the very first step involves constituting a small team of experts who are drawn from various departments within the organization, and they are trained to carry out audits. Once the training is over, an audit schedule is fixed and the audit is carried out. Such internal audit should be carried out at least once in 6 months and should be documented appropriately. This is because this is an indication about the commitment of the top management to improving the quality systems. Next, once the audit is carried out, the audit findings and discrepancies are reported to the top management in the form of a report, and corrective actions are suggested. This may be followed up with repeat audit as per pre-planned schedule. The purpose of such an internal audit is to ensure that adequate quality systems are maintained. It also helps to assess the compliance with CGMP and the SOPs. It helps to achieve consistency between manufacturing and testing facilities, and it helps to identify the problems at an inertial stage and correct the problems prior to a regulatory audit. Thus, internal audit has several advantages. It audits the systems and improves the systems. Not only that, it helps in the training of internal auditors, and based on this, the internal auditors, when they go back to their work desk or to their department, they can work in a much more systematic, planned manner and improve the quality on a day-to-day basis. There could be three types of internal audits that are carried out. Tier 1 audit involves a staff of the section or department of the company. So only one department audits itself. That becomes an internal audit of Tier 1. This requires a short time and focuses mainly on sanitization, housekeeping, and documentation within the department. Such an audit is carried out very frequently, maybe once a month or once in 2 months. Here, not much technical skills are required, rather some basic training in audit report generation is necessary. Next is Tier 2 type of internal audit, which involves a local QA group. So if a manufacturing firm has a location at Aurangabad, then the QA group of the Aurangabad forms the team that will carry out internal audit under Tier 2. The time required for carrying out the audit is slightly longer, and they focus on the quality systems rather than the internal housekeeping. The frequency is lesser as compared to Tier 1. This could be carried out once in 3 months or once in 6 months. And more specialized training is required for carrying out this work. And this Tier 2, as you can see, is the quality assurance group which is carrying out the audit. And you as students of quality assurance fit into this. So this is the significance of those who have studied quality assurance at the education level as well as taking appropriate training. Next comes Tier 3. Tier 3 is a more exclusive and less frequently carried out internal audit, which is carried out by the corporate group. Or it may also be carried out by an consultant that is hired by the company from an external agency. So sometimes you have a company which has multiple locations across the country, and you have a team that arrives from the corporate office to carry out the audit. An audit of such a type is called as corporate Tier 3 audit. Sometimes it also happens that the company employs consultants for auditing its facilities, and these external consultants carry out a Tier 3 type of audit. The focus of such an internal audit is to assess the readiness of the company for the regulatory audit where you have auditors coming from FDA. Frequency again is probably just before the FDA audit. And the auditors who arrive for this are highly trained, specialized, experienced, and are experts in GMP. Again, here quality assurance, those who have experience and exposure to quality assurance generally form a part of the corporate group or the consultant. Whenever an audit is carried out by an internal team, two things are mainly checked. That is, the activities that are carried out by each department or by the different departments within the company, and the documentation that is carried out by these departments. So the entire organization is audited in the form of different departments, and the documents that are maintained by these are checked. The next type of audit which we are going to look at is called as the external audit. Like I explained to you in one of the earlier slides, external audit is one that is carried out within the company by a team of auditors who belong to an external agency or consultancy. That is one. Another type of external audit is one in which the company sends its audit team to its supplier for auditing the supplier. Now, for example, for any product to be manufactured, raw materials and packaging materials are an important aspect that go into the production of the finished product. And these are sourced from what are called as vendors, isn't it? So the raw material comes from few vendors, and the packaging material comes from certain approved vendors and is used in the manufacture and packaging of the final product. So who are these vendors and how are they approved? These vendors are selected, finalized, and approved on the basis of auditing of their premises and their processes. Thus, external audit involves auditing, self-auditing of the company by an external consultant or auditing of the vendors by the company. The reason and advantages of this external audit is that it generates a confidence in the partnership between the manufacturer and the vendor. It ensures that whatever are the requirements of the manufacturer are understood by the vendor and complied with. It helps in reducing the in-house testing of all raw materials. This is because if there is adequate confidence in the vendor that he is supplying materials of the requisite quality, then the raw materials or the packaging materials need not be tested once again when it reaches the manufacturing premises. Thus, it reduces the time, effort, and money involved in retesting of materials that have been sourced if the vendor has been audited and approved. And all this process leads to reduction in the risk of failure and helps to improve the quality of the product. Thus, the external audit, once again I repeat, has several advantages. It generates confidence in the partnership with the vendor. It ensures that the requirements are understood and complied with. It reduces the amount of in-house testing of the starting materials and reduces the risk of failure. Like I told you, this is an audit that is generally carried out by the company on its vendors or subcontractors. This external audit is not really mandatorily binding on the company. However, it is in the benefit of the company, the benefits of which we saw in the previous slide. The auditors that are employed are either from the company itself or external auditors who have experience of GMP and are regulatory audited by their certification body. The third type of audit that we are going to discuss is the regulatory audit that is carried out by regulatory agencies of that country or the country to which the manufacturer wishes to export his goods. The purpose of carrying out such a regulatory audit is networking and confidence building between national inspection authorities, helps in development of quality systems as per the requirements of the consumer, and the whole exercise is to work towards global harmonization of GMP. So various regulatory agencies of various companies come together, they audit each other's facilities, and thus there is a uniform employment of GMP, uniform standardization of GMP across the globe, and uniform quality of the product. Some of the regulatory agencies which carry out these inspections and audits involve the MCA from UK, US FDA for USA, and these teams from these agencies visit the company and carry out audits. Most of the time, such audits are unannounced surprise audits, and the element of surprise is very essential to find out if quality is being routinely built into the product and not just an exercise that is carried out just before an FDA inspection. Okay, failure of this such a regulatory audit can have very serious consequences and ultimately lead to withdrawal of the license to manufacture or export or import, as the case may be. I've told you two live examples in one of my previous slides. Once such a regulatory audit is completed, a formal report will be delivered. If it is UK, then a verbal feedback report is given at the exit meeting, and the US FDA, in case of serious or critical non-compliances, gives what is called as a Form 483 in the meeting. So many a times you may hear your colleagues and seniors who are working in the industry talking about Form 483. Getting a Form 483 is a very serious matter and implies that there has been a failure which has been critical or major in nature. It is necessary to decide the purpose of which audit and be prepared for such an audit. To give you a few examples, there are different regulatory agencies in different countries. So which regulatory agency, to which country does the company wish to export the drugs? The company has to prepare itself as per the requirements of the regulatory agencies of that particular company. For example, it is necessary to know which regulatory agency is going to audit. Is it going to be the European Union? Is it the US, or is it WHO standards, or which standards need to be complied with? What are the marketing requirements of the various agencies? What are the company policies and procedures? What are the health regulatory agency procedures? And all these are important aspects that need to be first understood by the management and the audit team, and this should then lead to reversal of the site staff to be a part of the regulatory agency inspections so that they understand in a better manner what are the expectations from them. If the FDA inspection is that of the manufacturer's vendor or supplier, then the supplier should comply with the terms that are given to him by the manufacturer. So the FDA inspection could be of the manufacturer's firm, where the manufacturer's firm has to comply with the requirements as per the regulatory agency of the particular country, or it could be an audit, regulatory audit of the supplier for that manufacturer, who then has to comply with the terms and the conditions that are provided to him in his contract by the manufacturing firm. This is a very interesting question that has been posed on this slide. What is the role of this auditor? Is he a policeman or is he a consultant? Okay. Whether it is an internal auditor or an external auditor, what exactly is his role? What is he supposed to do? Is he supposed to only audit? Is he supposed to point out the mistakes? Is he supposed to provide corrective action, suggestions for corrective action? Okay. So there could be two types of auditors. One who plays the role of a policeman and one who plays the role of a consultant. So what is this policeman type of consultant going to do? This auditor, policeman type of auditor, this auditor remains completely objective, points out the gaps and deficiencies and discrepancies, but offers no assistance in solving these problems. So that's a policeman type of auditor. So who is going to take corrective action? It is the company and its employees, other than the auditor, who is going to take corrective action. They are going to break their heads over exactly what is the problem, how can it be solved, and implement the solution. A consultant type of auditor points out the gaps, offers suggestions for corrective action. However, the responsibility for the final design and execution of the corrective and preventive action, that is CAPA, remains with the organization. Okay. There could be some auditors who, while carrying out supplier auditing, would be a policeman, but at the same time provide suggestions just like a consultant. So the role of the auditor is varied. It could be policeman or it could be a consultant, and or it could be a combination of both depending on the management requirements. In the previous slide, we looked at the role of the auditor. Now what about his training and qualification? When we were learning about audits and what is the role of an auditor, in my earlier slides, we discussed the fact that the auditor should be qualified, skilled, technically trained, and have the experience. Thus, the auditor is one who is well trained in all technical operations, including handling of equipment, the facilities, familiarization with the facilities, processes, and the quality systems. Now, what this point tells us is that to be a successful auditor, the pharmacist, the skilled person, should have requisite experience, exposure, and handling of equipment, facilities, processes, as well as quality systems. Therefore, ideally, the person who wishes to be an auditor should first work in various departments like production, packaging, regulatory, quality control, etc. That is the first requirement, familiarity with the technical operations. Next, familiarity with the regulatory requirements of the countries to which the management wishes to export their products. Ability to detect data integrity problems. Now, data integrity is a very serious issue that needs to be addressed, and for this purpose, I have put a separate video, a YouTube video on data integrity in the Google Classroom. Please refer it to understand more about data integrity and the problems that arise. Auditors should be familiar with the auditing methods and various practices followed. They should be familiar with the company policy, contractual requirements and expectations. So these are the basic requirements for the auditors, some of which they will gain from their own experience, some of which they will get through training. In addition, training in investigative interviewing techniques, knowledge of legal aspects such as the drug law, in our case drugs and cosmetics law, regulatory agency authorities is very necessary. Regulatory agency methods and practices for inspections should be known to the auditor, so he should be trained in these techniques, and he should have good interpersonal skills. As a part of the regulatory requirements, it is necessary to carry out internal audits. However, regulatory requirements do not require that the auditor should be from a department or area that is separate from the area to be audited. A person from the same area, colleague from the same department or area, can carry out the internal training, and this self-inspection has been found to be very beneficial in improving the overall quality of the product. However, internal audit will succeed only if the internal auditor is empowered to understand, inspect, audit, evaluate, and report his observations without any fear of consequence or conflict of interest or any pressure or undue influence from the audited facility or the department. A successful audit requires well-trained, skilled auditors who are able to report their findings to the top management without any undue pressure, and therefore the companies generally utilize personnel from the quality organization, that is corporate quality, or sometimes a fully separate audit group or compliance organization may be installed in place to conduct internal audits. Some other companies rely on external consultants. In sensitive matters where there is concern about litigation, many companies arrange for auditors to be retained under the attorney-client privilege. So many a times an auditor gets access to a lot of confidential information about the company which should not leak outside. Therefore, in order to prevent any untoward incident of leakage of confidential data or infringement of patents, the companies generally they sign an agreement with the auditor whereby the auditor is bound to secrecy. So the rules and regulations and the types of such arrangements may vary from one country to another. An audit is a very serious matter wherein an audit plan is drawn up, audit team is organized, and audit inspections are carried out and findings are reported to the management. So these are activities that require a lot of planning, effort, time and money, and therefore are carried out on an infrequent basis. However, if the company is committed to quality and the management is very keen, then many a times each department does its own inspection or self-inspection. The purpose of carrying out the self-inspection is to evaluate the compliance with GMP of that particular department and detect any shortcomings in the implementation of GMP and to recommend the necessary corrective actions. So this is performed routinely by all departments, as well as in case of certain special events such as failure of a batch or rejections or product recall, etc. So self-inspection is another type of audit that is carried out, but it is more of a self-introspection where each department looks inwards and tries to evaluate the extent of its compliance with GMP and to detect any shortcomings and to rectify them. Whenever any self-inspection is carried out, it focuses on the personnel, that is the skill as well as the training, the premises, the maintenance, overall maintenance of the building and the equipment, storage areas where starting materials and finished products are stored, the equipment that are used for manufacturing, the production and in-process controls, whether they are adequate and they are in place, as well as the quality control aspect of the organization. Similarly, documentation, sanitation and hygiene, validation program and revalidation schedules, calibrations, recall procedures, managing of complaints, control of packaging material, especially labels, and results of previous self-inspections and corrective actions taken also needs to be self-inspected periodically. Let us once again look at the important criteria to be assessed and audited by the auditors. So in this slide, we look at the GMP audits that are carried out in the QA and QC programs. The auditor will review mainly documents such as SOPs. He will audit the employee practices and behavior, which is reflected in the records that are created, generated, and the SOPs that are followed by the employees. The auditors will compare the master specification against compendial and regulatory requirements. They will check, assess, and verify the testing data and the validation data that has been generated in the analytical development laboratories as well as formulation laboratories. They will check the validation test reports and compare them against raw data. What is raw data? Raw data is nothing but the results of the various tests and validation processes carried out and recorded in the notebooks by the individual analyst. They will verify whether corrective action has been taken in response to the earlier audit findings. What are the benefits that arise from carrying out these audits? We have already discussed this, yet it is again compiled here for revision purpose. Assuring compliance with GMP norms, detecting potential problems before they can affect the quality of the product, implementing an effective program improvement, and increasing the awareness of the management and its commitment towards quality. The FDA conducts routine inspections of all pharmaceutical manufacturers to determine if the manufacturing and control procedures conform to GMPs. Also, FDA investigators make unannounced visits. I have explained this to you earlier. Surprise visit to the manufacturing facility to examine the facilities, equipments, personnel, and all sorts of records and documentation. So, in order to undergo successfully these FDA inspections and audits and not to get any major non-compliance reports, it is very necessary to carry out either self-inspection or internal auditing or external auditing with a view to assuring GMP compliance that can assure the FDA that the manufacturing the top management of the manufacturing firm is committed to quality. An important advantage of auditing is that it is able to detect not just problems but potential problems. Now, what do we mean by potential problems? These are instances where if a certain action is not taken, a problem can occur in the future. This problem may be minor or this problem may be major and critical enough to affect the quality of the product. Hence, detecting potential problems is a very important area and an advantage of carrying out periodic audits. It so happens that GMP audits that are carried out may find certain objectionable conditions or situations which is unnoticed, unknown to those who are working in that department, may it be production or QC or even QA or for that matter the management. The auditor who is a third person would be able to see whether these actions are occurring randomly, frequently or not, and he can correlate this to other potential GMP problems that are occurring or likely to occur in the near future. Another important advantage of the audits is that it brings about improvement in the quality by improving the systems and the programs. This is brought about by the auditing the system, the quality system, and encouraging and suggesting changes in SOPs, modifying the manufacturing equipment or procedure to improve the quality, upgrading equipments or procedures, recommending improvement in employee training programs, and by developing new or revised documentation systems as per the recommendations of the auditing committee. Thus, the auditing team helps to bring about improvements in quality by improving the program by in several areas such as the documentation, such as SOPs, modifying the equipments, procedures, or upgradation or maintenance by bringing about by recommending employee training programs or by complete upgradation or revision of the documentation system. Auditing helps to increase the management awareness towards the lacunae that are present in the system and motivates the management to bring about changes and improvements. For any audit that is carried out, there could be two possible outcomes. Either the system is good, so there are no problems, or problems are found. Okay. Now, if the system is good enough and there are no problems, then well and good. The management is doing an excellent job and the employees are motivated and they are dedicated to incorporating quality into the product. However, if problems are found and these are reported to the management by the auditor's team, this does not mean that the management takes action upon the employees. What the management does, it takes appropriate steps to eliminate the problem. Okay, so the employees need not be always under a sword thinking that they will face the consequences of the audit. No, the purpose of the audit is to bring about improvements in the system, and that also means improvement in the employees. Therefore, an audit is not about finding objectionable conditions. It is all about improving the objectionable conditions. Okay. And it is also possible that in some cases no problems are found. But that does not mean that problems do not exist. This could also happen because the auditor is unable to detect the objectionable condition or the problem. And this points to a lack of training on part of the auditors. Thus, it is very important for the management, which is planning an audit, to select the audit team based on their training, experience, exposure, the objective to be achieved, and the country for which they are preparing their organization. So, these are the important elements of a systematic audit program. The audit should be up to the expectations and the philosophies that are practiced by the management. Audit should be carried out in certain format, and any of these three approaches should be used. There should be a proper checklist of criteria that are written and standard operating procedures to be followed for carrying out an audit. This audit is not a one-off thing. It should be conducted periodically in a planned manner. The auditing team should comprise of specially trained personnel who have the necessary experience and expertise to carry out the audit, and they should prepare a written audit report for submission to the management, based on which the management can take corrective action and can insist on a re-audit or re-audit or a planned frequency of audit in future. Audit methods can be divided into three categories: the checklist format, the GMP regulation format, and the systems analysis method. As we move forward, we will look at each of these in detail. The word checklist is self-explanatory. It means a list of points that will be checked, against which the actual situation will be checked. So a checklist is prepared by the auditor, which contains all the points to be checked. So the auditor will read from the checklist, verify whether physically that condition or situation or equipment exists and is in working condition, and put a tick mark against that point. Thus, the checklist is used as a GMP audit guide and used to report the findings. It is nothing but a series of questions or instructions that are grouped or that are listed in a logical order. Certain blocks may be or ticks may be used to record the answer, and also a space may be provided to make enter comments. So checklist format is a very simple technique of auditing any system or process. It contains a list of questions, a list of points that are going to be physically verified. What are the advantages of this checklist format? I have already explained to you what is this checklist format. It is a list of questions that address important issues related to the quality and ensure its compliance. It is a list against which the actual tasks are checked. Because of that, this format is a very simple, convenient and easy to use for any desired subject area. It is developed and it is upgraded over time with the help of the knowledge that the auditors gain. The questions are asked in a logical order in such a manner that it is very easy to detect problems or potential problems, and it allows the report to be prepared in a minimum period of time, thus saving a lot of time and energy. What are the disadvantages of this checklist format? Since this is a checklist that is prepared, let us say, by one person or a team and is used by several persons who belong to the same team or otherwise, the questions may be interpreted in more than one way, possibly because of a language barrier or because of biases or because of some hidden meaning or hints within it. Understanding and checking the questions is not very easy. A limited amount of questions can be asked related to the activities that are carried out in the organization. The amount and type of questions that are provided are limited. Also, not every issue may be covered, and each auditor has to use his own judgment while doing the evaluation, because the checklist is a set of questions that may mean different things to different auditors. Therefore, his own judgment is necessary while carrying out the auditing as per the checklist format. So far, we have discussed a lot about the significance and importance of internal auditing. However, it is interesting to note that internal auditing is not mandatory. US drug GMP, that is 21 CFR 211, does not specifically require internal auditing for pharmaceutical organizations. However, there are certain other US regulations which do. Okay. For example, the US Medical Device QSR lays down the device GMP regulation which requires internal audits. And this is specified under 21 CFR 820.22. This is not important or mandatory for us as pharmacists. However, we should know what the US Medical Device QSR states about a quality audit, which is why I have put it down here. The 21 CFR 820 says, each manufacturer shall establish procedures for quality audits and conduct such audits to assure that the quality system is in compliance with the established requirements and to determine the effectiveness of the quality system, so on and so forth. So the quality audit describes that there should be an established procedure for audit, and such audit should be conducted for assuring that the quality system is in compliance with the laid down regulations and requirements. Another CFR, that is 21 CFR 1270, which defines the US human cells, tissues and cellular and tissue based product regulation, states that you must periodically perform for management review a quality audit of the activities that are related to core CGTP requirements. Okay, so although US FDA under 21 CFR 211 does not mandate the conduction of internal audits or self-inspection, there are other US bodies which require self-inspection or internal auditing, such as 21 CFR 820 for US medical devices and 21 CFR 1270 and 1271 for US human cells, tissues and cellular and tissue based product regulation. As against the US FDA, which does not mandate internal audit, the European Union EU requires self-inspection and internal quality audit, and this is described in its regulatory federal register, the EudraLex, volume 4, part 1, chapter 1 on quality management, where it is written that the system of quality assurance appropriate for the manufacture of medicinal products should ensure that there is a procedure for self-inspection or quality audit, which will regularly appraise the effectiveness and applicability of the quality assurance system. Okay, so thus it is mandated by the European Union to have self-inspection or quality audit. There is an entire chapter in EudraLex, that is chapter 9, which is dedicated to self-inspection and is devoted completely to the requirement, and it says that self-inspection should be conducted in order to monitor the implementation and compliance with GMP principles and should propose necessary corrective measures. All these are slightly complex words and long sentences. However, if you read them very slowly from my notes, you will understand that European Union lays a lot of importance and significance to self-inspection. It has an entire chapter devoted to self-inspection, and it says one important sentence which I have quoted is that self-inspections should be conducted in order to monitor the implementation and compliance with GMP principles and should propose necessary corrective measures. While the US FDA does not insist on self-inspection or quality audit, an important point to note is that the auditing of suppliers is an FDA expectation. The FDA does not insist but expect that the pharmaceutical organization has carried out an audit of its vendors and suppliers. And this is very clear in 21 CFR 211 point number 22A, which states that quality control unit shall be responsible for approving or rejecting drug products manufactured, processed, packed or held under contract by another company. So if we were to interpret this sentence, it means that the manufacturing firm is responsible for quality of goods that come in, whether it is raw materials or packaging materials. It is also responsible for quality of goods that are manufactured under its name but at a different location, under loan license or under a third party license. And this approval and rejection is only possible if the pharmaceutical firm audits on a regular basis its vendors, suppliers, and loan licensees and contract parties. Similarly, 21 CFR 211.84D states that containers and closures shall be tested for conformity with all the written specifications. Now, obviously, the pharmaceutical firm is not itself manufacturing containers and closures. It is sourcing these from vendors. That means it is responsible for the containers and closures that are supplied to it by its vendors. In lieu of such testing by the manufacturer, a certificate of testing may be accepted from the supplier, provided that at least a visual identification is conducted on such containers or closures, and provided that the manufacturer establishes the reliability of the supplier's test through appropriate validation of the supplier's test results at appropriate intervals. Now, what this means is that it is the responsibility of the pharmaceutical firm that is manufacturing the finished product to ensure the quality of the packaging material. And for doing this, it has to either test the packaging material itself once it reaches its premises, or it should develop a confidence in the vendor, the packaging material vendor. And how will such a confidence be developed? Such a confidence will only be developed through validation of the supplier's test results at appropriate intervals, which means basically this is possible only through auditing of the supplier's systems and goods. Isn't it? Coming to ICH Q10, which refers to the pharmaceutical quality system requirements. Here, the pharmaceutical quality system, including the management responsibilities, extends to the control and view of any outsourced activity and quality of purchased materials. In one of the previous slides, we learned that ICH Q10 covers the entire life cycle of the finished formulation. However, it is important to note that the responsibilities also extend to the control and review of outsourced activity, which could include buying of raw materials, packaging goods, loan license, or third party also. The pharmaceutical company is ultimately responsible to ensure that the processes are in place to assure the control of outsourced activities as well as quality of purchased goods. Therefore, the activities that need to be carried out at the pharmaceutical firm end to comply with ICH Q10 is pre-qualification of the supplier, defining the role and responsibilities via a written agreement, monitoring and reviewing of supplier performance, and monitoring of incoming shipments to ensure that they are only from approved sources. Okay, so while the US FDA does not directly insist on internal audit, any pharmaceutical organization and its technical persons who are well versed with the documents, regulations of US FDA realize that although auditing is not a GMP requirement, it is a FDA expectation. And therefore, the company will ensure these 4 points as in compliance with ICH Q10, that is pre-qualification of suppliers, defining the roles and responsibilities in the pharmaceutical organization as well as within the vendor's organization via written agreement, periodic monitoring and review of supplier performance, periodic auditing of the vendor, and monitoring of incoming shipments to ensure that they are from approved sources. So we have looked at the checklist format, and now we look at the GMP regulation approach. This GMP regulation approach is similar to the checklist approach, but the basic elements are derived from the subparts of the regulations that are given under the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. So where we have, the US FDA 21 CFR, where we have different subparts from B to K, where subpart B relates to organization and personnel. I'm sure you have already read it. Subpart C relates to the facility, buildings and facilities. Subpart D deals with equipment. E deals with production and processing controls. F relates to production and packaging control. Subpart H relates to holding and distribution of goods. Subpart I is related to quality control testing and quality assurance testing. Subpart J deals with the records and reports that are generated. And subpart K refers to the returned and salvaged drugs and their fit. So, as per US FDA, the various subparts have already been classified, and auditing is carried out on the basis of the subparts. So, an auditor may be assigned the auditing of subpart B or subpart H or subpart J. Accordingly, he will carry out in a style that is appropriate to the auditing requirements. Next, we come to the systems analysis method, where the different problems that are likely to affect the quality of the product are identified and investigated. This is done by the FDA investigators, who describe the organized method for determining the potential problem. And this is a very brief and subpart of the routine audits that are carried out. So this, we are not going to study this too much in detail. Having understood what are audits, what is the significance of audits, let us now look at the different steps in carrying out audits. As we know, the management has to fully plan for carrying out the audit. It has to select the auditors, train the auditors, carry out, the auditing team has to carry out the audit, and the subsequent report has to be generated. Thus, the very first step in carrying out the audit is to establish which audit data or which element is to be considered and audited. Okay, so the very objective of the audit has to be first known. Formal written SOPs for auditing are very necessary. Just like we have SOPs for operating various equipments and instruments, an SOP for carrying out the audit also needs to be in place. An effective use of the written criteria in the SOP should be done to ensure that the conditions and practices remain under a suitable state of control. Thus, the SOPs should establish the responsibility for audit data review, the personnel responsible for recommendations, and the decisions to be taken regarding corrective actions. Each firm must establish the optimum time interval between audits based on the activity that is carried out, based on the significance of each activity, the chances of potential of problems arising during carrying out of the various procedures, and the country to which the data will be sent, and the country from which the FDA inspection auditor will come will determine the frequency of auditing. So therefore, before establishing the frequency of the audits, the purpose of audit should be laid down. The objectives, scope, and the depth to which auditing should be carried out should be defined. And prior history of non-compliance or complaints or major or minor issues should be studied before the audit frequency is established by the management. Once established, the audits are carried out as per the pre-planned frequency. These audits, let us assume that we are not talking of internal audit now, but we are talking of external audit, where you have a team coming from the corporate, or an external consultant employed by the management to audit their firm, then the audit will be carried out as per the frequency that has been developed after the considering the above factors, and the audit may be via an announced visit, a planned audit, or an unannounced audit, that is unplanned audit. In case of announced visit, advance notice is given before the audit. So the let us say there is an audit of the manufacturing department, tablet manufacturing department. The department is given 2 days prior notice that your department will be audited on so and so date. This is the announced visit. However, this visit will not serve too much, will not have too much benefit, because it gives the employees of the officers in the department time to cover up any problems. Also, these people are then make major adjustment in their behavior, and during the visit they cover up all potential problems and issues. However, there are benefits from such announced visits. That is, because there is an audit, it is known that audit will be conducted every 4 months, every 6 months, and 2 days prior to audit the date is announced, efficiency is improved. Also, on a routine basis, the officers of the department will make sure that the documentation is up to date and the necessary records are well organized and can be retrieved fast whenever an audit is possible. Also, it ensures that people are not absent or busy with other jobs on that day. The key personnel are available for carrying out the audit to the satisfaction of the audit team. As against this, unannounced audits are when suddenly one fine morning the auditing team lands into the department and starts looking at various documents, records, systems and procedures. And the purpose of carrying out such unannounced audit is to view the conditions and practices that are being followed there by the people, and for observing the employees' behavior as well as observing the equipment and facility to check whether they are in working condition, whether they are validated, calibrated, whether the logbooks are really being filled or not. So the major benefit of such an unannounced visit is that it allows observation of normal conditions and practices, and therefore helps in detection of genuine problems. Who are these auditors? The auditors, as we know, and I've told you again and again, are specially trained person who are trained, who are qualified, who are trained, and who have experience, expertise, and who are highly motivated. Note this very important point, that selection of auditors is based not only on their qualification, but also based on their knowledge and experience in manufacturing of various formulations, QC principles, QA aspects, as well as first-hand experience in dealing with GMP matters. A good auditor is one who is aware of the firm's SOPs, has knowledge of the documentation of the company, and is aware of the integration by the various departments and the interdepartmental working. The auditor has knowledge of scientific principles, and he is trained in chemistry, engineering, statistical aspects, as well as pharmaceutical aspects. Also, the auditor is trained in GMP, and this training is theoretical training as well as cumulative knowledge from the years of first-hand experience, which comes from the working daily in the various departments as well as attending various formal training sessions. And as you can see, let me take a brief gap here and explain to you that as you can see, to achieve success in your career and professional life, you not only need to have knowledge, theoretical knowledge. You need to have practical experience. You should undergo regular training and keep yourself updated in the various aspects of quality assurance, quality control, rules and regulations that are laid down by the regulatory agencies of various countries in order to become a successful counselor, auditor, consultant, etc. Selection of the different members for the audit team will thus depend on each individual's experience, theoretical and practical knowledge. Also, how familiar they are with the issues of that particular department and how familiar they are with the area or the system to be audited will determine which of the members are included in the audit team. Why is an audit team required and not a single individual? This is because the auditor has to cover many different systems and to check and evaluate a large amount of data, which is physically impossible for one person, a single person. Therefore, a team comprising of experts in various areas is put together in the audit team. And the composition of such a team will vary depending on the nature and the scope of the audit. Each team, audit team, should have a leader, and the leader is a person who is generally a senior auditor with a lot of experience, who has extensive knowledge of the firm's operations and exhibits strong leadership qualities. So thus we have an audit team which is headed by a leader, several other members who are experts in various areas. Then the size of the team, whether it is 5 people, 10 people or 15 people or even 2 people, will depend on the size of the firm, the total number of products manufactured as well as the control systems in place, the depth, extent and depth of the audit that is required and the objective of the audit. Once the audit team has been put into place, the team carries out the audit in compliance with the objectives of the audit and it has to prepare the audit report. Such an audit report should contain complete details of the program and it should suggest corrective actions taken to eliminate problems, and the report should measure the overall adequacy of the audit program. There are two important reporting phases after the audit. One is preliminary report during the audit. So as in when the audit is going on, if any discrepancies and shortcomings are observed, these may be conveyed verbally to the officers present in that department. And the second phase is preparing a final written documented audit report, which will be presented to the management. The preliminary reporting, which is done in the department itself during the audit, is beneficial in terms of having an open dialogue with the employees working in the department, direct communication of the findings and shortcomings to those affected persons, and also healthy discussion, which may help in understanding why these problems occurred in the first place. And the final report by the audit team has to go to the management, because the management will then review the final report, determine the steps that need to be taken to eliminate the deficiencies. Also, the management sincerely encourages detection of problems and will be able to express appreciation for helping in improving their quality operations. Once received by the management goes through the audit report and then shares it with the supervisor or the manager, who further discusses it with the ground level employees, and all the workers, employees and managerial personnel are given an opportunity to explain their views and ideas about the audit findings. Thus, the final report is discussed by everybody from the audit team, the management and the employees who are directly or indirectly affected by the report, This healthy discussion brings about recommendations, suggestions to the top management, which can then implement them for improving and maintaining the final quality of the product. Thus, auditing as per regulations and compliance with regulations is a very important activity and a task to be carried out by the organization. Involvement and commitment of the top management is of foremost importance, without which the audit that is carried out is a fruitless exercise that will not result in any type of improvement in quality. The most important audit is the regulatory audit that is carried out by the regulatory agencies, either announced or mostly unannounced. But prior to that, it is very essential to carry out a self-inspection, internal audit or an external audit for the company to prove to the regulatory agencies that it is committed to improving and maintaining the quality of the final product. So, with this short description about audits and overview, I will now give you plenty of notes for the audits, various types of audits. So, number of checklists you will find in my Google Classroom, which will help you to understand the different types of audits in a much better manner. A lot of rules and regulations and important points regarding audits and regulatory compliances has been uploaded in the Google Classroom for your reference. Please go through the same and revert back to me in case of any doubts, difficulties or questions. So with this, I end the topic of audits and regulatory compliances. Thank you.